And it is a true honor and pleasure to introduce our speaker this evening, who is going to be talking about his book. You can go to any of your favorite independent book sites to go ahead and purchase that. It has just recently come out. Dr. Khary Oronde Polk is an associate professor of Black Studies and Sexuality, Women's and Gender Studies at Amherst College. He is a cultural historian of the African diaspora, a specialist in LGBTQ studies, and a scholar of race, gender, and sexuality in the U.S. military. Polk received his PhD in American Studies from New York University and teaches courses on Black history, Black sexuality, military history, Black European studies, race and the American imagination, and queer theory. He's written for the Studio Museum of Harlem, the Journal of Negro History, Women's Studies Quarterly, Gawker, and the Journal Biography and Interdisciplinary Quarterly. Polk has also contributed essays to a number of queer of color anthologies, including If We Have to Take Tomorrow, Corpus, and Think Again. What you see in front of you is his new book published by the University of North Carolina Press in 2020, Contagions of Empire, Scientific Racism, Sexuality, and Black Military Workers Abroad, 1898 to 1948, examines the shifting views of Black military workers through the first half of the 20th century as the United States increased its global empire and warfare. Now, ladies and gentlemen, with a title like that, I am going to again say that we are going to be talking about some things that are not necessarily G-rated, but history is not G-rated. And if you don't mind, Dr. Polk, I am actually gonna say, as we were talking before this, you said, well, I'm going to actually be using some of the words genitalia, and my parents are going to be on, might be watching this event. With that, take your audiences as if you need to censor or change where your location is, but you really don't want to miss this conversation. It is eye-opening and will really help you understand this era of history in the World War I timeframe and also influence how you understand our present. Yeah, with that, Dr. Polk, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you all so much. And I'd like to thank Laura Voigt, Camille Coolidge, and the National World War I Museum and Memorial for having me. And of course, for providing me with the cover image of my book. And as you'll see, the original image will pop up later in my talk. So please stay tuned. Okay, so I'm going to. Here we go. All right. So as an introduction, I want to talk a little bit about how my book came to be. Despite the fact that both of my grandfathers fought in racially segregated or colored units in World War II, and that I myself am the child of an African-American military family, my efforts to write a theoretical history of Black soldiers abroad in the early to mid 20th century have at times seemed anything but inevitable. In truth, it was only after this project was largely complete that I inquired about the military travels of my male forebears. As it turns out, Leroy Coleman, my mother's father, served as a private in the Philippines during the war, while my father's namesake, Harry Polk Sr., experienced the cosmopolitan movement of station and nation that exemplified the travels of Black military workers overseas during the course of the conflict. Harry Sr. served with the 366th Infantry Regiment, whose motto, "Labor conquers all things," aptly captures the intersections of race, labor, and masculinity that lay at the heart of my analysis. My aunt Ina shared with me a leather-bound pictorial history of the regiment that had been passed down in the Polk family and within which my grandfather had taken copious notes. In addition to tagging his friends in the photographs, scrawling, "Swell pal," "Okay," and "Crazy" under their faces, he kept a detailed list of the nearly 80 places where he had been stationed during the war on the book's final page. In the United States, Harry Sr. traveled from the top of the eastern seaboard down to Louisiana, making stops in Yarmouth, Spartanburg, and Baton Rouge along the way, before shipping off overseas to North Africa and Europe. After spending time in Iran, Algiers, and Casablanca, his regiment joined the 92nd Infantry Division in Italy, where he made more than 20 changes of station in the country. From Augusta and Palermo in Sicily, he likely journeyed up and down the boot of the peninsula, seeing Naples, Anzio, Rome, Civitavecchia, Pisa, and Genoa during his tour of duty abroad. He was wounded twice in battle and received a Purple Heart for his service during World War II. Though my grandfathers had passed on before I came of age to ask them questions about their time in the military, the belated revelation that they had both served overseas in places I had written so passionately about proved to me, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that this history, even at its most academic registers, was a personal and familial one. The bulk of my own childhood was spent growing up in two nations markedly altered through their mid-century encounters with American militarism, the United Kingdom and Okinawa, Japan. As an American citizen living abroad, I had a strong investment in questioning how African-American cultural identity might be produced outside of the contiguous United States and within foreign nations willing to accommodate the needs of America's military empire. Later, as a graduate student within an American studies program, I noted a curricular silence on the material role American soldiers played as subjects and agents of American imperialism. Considering my own narrative, I began to wonder how a history of African-American soldiers abroad in the 20th century might act as a productive intervention within African diasporic and Black internationalist discourses. I began this project as a racial and sexual history of the US military abroad. However, as the archive I assembled grew, it became something slightly different. It soon became a study in which race and sexuality became the optics through which Black people, conscripted into imperial service, wrestled with notions of death, honor, and sacrifice. The concept of American martial honor, far from immune from the historical machinations of race, class, and gender, gains its greatest expressions through these registers of difference. That all said, I'd like to begin my lecture for the evening, the bulk of which is taken from my fourth chapter, Contagious Immunity, Race, Sexuality, and the Black Venereal Body Abroad. In June 1919, an African-American officer working in the U.S. Army's Military Intelligence Division sent a report to his director in Washington, D.C., describing a mass meeting of ex-soldiers, sailors, and war workers that had been held by the League of Democracy at the Howard Theater. This coalition of Black veterans and war workers met in part to rebut charges made by a white colonel from the 92nd Division who had said that Black troops were cowards and were, quote, dangerous to no one except themselves and women. For 2 years, Major Walter Loving had served as an undercover agent in the MID, monitoring groups within the Black community that were seen as potentially disruptive to the war effort. In this program of racial reconnaissance, the MID used Black operatives to observe and document African-American political activity and cataloged their findings in what came to be known as the Negro Subversion Files, containing reports on both radical and centrist Black organizations. The Negro Subversion Files compiled information about charges of racial discrimination made by African American soldiers and civilians, and kept abreast of the state of morale of Black troops at camps in the United States and the American Expeditionary Forces overseas. "Until we have colored soldiers commanding white men," one of the speakers reportedly said, "we do not want white officers commanding colored men. We owe no special allegiance to a government that discriminates, segregates, and permits lynching and burning at the stake." Among the war veterans and war workers invited to speak, Major Loving singled out one woman by name, Mrs. A.M. Curtis. Her actual name was Namayoka Gertrude Curtis, and her first name was often shortened to Nama. Though, as was standard practice at the time, she had adopted the initials of her husband, Austin, for the bulk of her public and professional career. Now, Namayoka Curtis was an exceptional woman who no doubt would have taken exception to being characterized or labeled as a Negro subversive by military officials. While we cannot know whether these specific words critiquing discrimination, segregation, and lynching were uttered by her, it is clear that MID viewed her as someone whose political activism on behalf of African-American officers threatened military order, making her worthy of surveillance. Now, this was a sea change in how she was formerly viewed by the Army, which had treated her as the quintessential military matriarch since the days of the Spanish-Cuban-American War. In 1898, on orders from President William McKinley himself, Nama Curtis had traveled south to New Orleans to recruit Black women nurses to care for soldiers sick with yellow fever in Cuba. Fever outbreaks during the war had compromised the health of the U.S. Army to such an extent that civilian and military officials authorized new protocols to expand its enlistment criteria beyond the commonplace prerequisites of whiteness and manhood. Because of a belief that African Americans were immune to yellow fever, an idea forged within the crucible of American slavery, Black women were recruited to serve as fever nurses in Cuba, while Black men were conscripted into immune regiments during the conflict. But one might question the wisdom of sending a Black woman from Washington, D.C. to recruit nurses in Louisiana, Alabama, and Florida at the turn of the 20th century, given the local systems of Jim Crow bureaucracy primed to impede her mobility at any stop along the route. In fact, the decision displayed the McKinley administration's deeply pragmatic response to the fact of racial segregation, as well as its good fortune to have the remarkable moxie of Nama Curtis at their disposal. Since most white Americans, unless alerted to the contrary, received her as a white woman. Curtis's fair skin no doubt helped her as she navigated the Jim Crow South. In a family history provided by her daughter, Curtis was described as, quote, blonde and a blonde blue-eyed matron of medium height. And in appearance, she was a blonde Caucasian, end quote. Given the overlapping rash of Jim Crow laws segregating public spaces and conveyances in the southeastern states she traveled, her complexion likely granted her a privilege that many of the Black women she recruited did not possess. Curtis's physical appearance was frequently commented upon during her lifetime. Reporters described her as a woman of culture and beauty, and alternatively, as a woman of mystery. And yet, History suggests that the white skin privilege she did enjoy, she used strategically as a tool of racial advancement. Thus, to view her solely at face value, to read her efforts to recruit African-American nurses as merely the actions of a fair-skinned lackey of the McKinley administration, desperate to stem the scourge of yellow fever in Cuba, is to crudely misread the character and comportment of Mrs. A.M. Curtis. Her organization of immune nurses was only a highlight of a public career marked by her remarkable penchant for civil engagement around matters of race and representation. Her administrative prowess, proximity to political power, and willingness to flout orthodoxies of the color line spawned critics and admirers within the Black and white communities she lived and worked within, adding to her national renown. 21 years had passed since her own military service, and in that time, Curtis had become a fixture among Washington's Black social elite, remaining committed to the cause of racial uplift through two decades of local and national acts of political advocacy and humanitarianism. So, while we cannot know exactly what Curtis said at the Howard Theater in June 1919 that led to her inclusion on the list of Negro subversives, it is more than likely she announced to the audience her own stake in the treatment of Black officers. All three of her sons, Austin Maurice Jr., Arthur, and Merrill, had been commissioned as first lieutenants in the Army during the war. As the male scions of her family lineage fought in France, surely with her blessings, the mother of four's commitment to ending racial discrimination in the military became a highly personal affair. Her sons were emblematic of modern Black manhood, new Negroes in a new century, and the future of her family might be made or revoked through their entanglement with American militarism. As a patriot and as a mother, Curtis's investment in what we might call Negro futurity, once so compatible with Army policy, abraded MID's efforts to assign a standard typology to Negro subversives, whose characteristics ranged from the patriotically indignant to the radically seditious. Yet even under this umbrella of political generalities, the Negro subversive files reveal covert attempts made by the white officer corps to identify a distinct racial difference among African-American soldiers, to prove, in a sense, that Black people were biologically and culturally inferior, and thus unfit for military service. On October 21st, 1918, the MID sent a secret bulletin for intelligence officers entitled Special Bulletin, The Negro Problem in the Army. The document stated at the outset that its purpose was not to make recommendations on the best practices for handling Black troops. Rather, the MID was on a fact-finding mission about the habits, conduct, and complaints of the soldiers of color under their command. The 43-question survey covered a range of topics, all meant to offer a better taxonomy of the newly conscripted Black soldier and his capacities for military use. In the stateside responses to the questionnaire, one trope recurred in the correspondence that signaled a widespread belief in the biological and moral inferiority of African-American troops. The figure of the sick and sexually infectious Black soldier. The term venereal, as an adjective and as a noun, was used to classify Black men as morally degraded, physically unfit, and contagious. Therefore, modes of exclusion, confinement, and control were implemented to segregate venereals from the rest of the healthy population in camp. However, the imperfect practice of these modes of control made it possible to view all Black men as sexually infectious and unworthy of military service. contributing to the already existing beliefs about the Black immune body forged in slavery, and I'll be happy to say more about this in the Q&A. These memos reveal that the anxieties cataloged in the Negro subversion files were sexual as well as racial. The sexuality of Black men, considered an untrammeled domain of vice and ignorance to many military officials, provoked feelings of resignation and disgust in the officers who responded to the questionnaire. At Camp Grant in Illinois, for example, one officer wrote that, quote, "The great number of venereals among the colored soldiers at Camp Grant have caused them to be regarded as a menace to the community, and accordingly, they are not welcomed," which resulted in a policy of not letting any of the men go out on pass. Now, the conditions at Camp Grant were seen as a microcosm of a larger problem of mustering Black men into service around the country. And to that end, Major Loving went on a tour of camps in Kentucky, Arkansas, Alabama, Georgia, South Carolina, North Carolina, New York, and Virginia to personally attest to the conditions of morale among Black recruits and to make suggestions based on his findings. Loving found a culture of indifference regarding the health of Black soldiers and neglect in their care. At Camp Humphreys in Virginia, Loving wrote that, quote, "The venereals also mingle with other soldiers in the YMCA tent and participate in games and sports therein, to the detriment of the health of the well soldiers." He also recounted a story of meeting a visibly sick soldier sitting alone on a bench, suffering from an advanced case of syphilis. He could scarcely walk. "I also found this man to be sharing the tent with three other soldiers who were not suffering from any venereal diseases." Loving was troubled by the overall laxity shown in the control of Black soldiers in venereal stockades and worried about the physical and ideological effects of housing sick and well soldiers together. Beyond this, he found the medical treatment received by sick soldiers woefully negligent and highlighted the case of Camp Zachary Taylor in Kentucky as prime rationale for, quote, "the urgent necessity of colored physicians to care for colored soldiers and especially for venereal cases among colored soldiers," end quote. Camp Zachary Taylor had a development battalion of quarantined men, and its single unit housed soldiers suffering from lameness, rheumatism, and venereal diseases. It was the neglect shown toward the last group of men by white physicians that alarmed him and gave credence to his direct appeal for more Black doctors to be commissioned as officers of Black battalions. "The white physician is all right so far as his ability is concerned," Loving wrote, "but he cannot and will not take the interest in these different venereal cases as the colored physician will." Loving was explicit in identifying the underlying factor he believed was behind the negligence shown to Black men diagnosed with sexually transmitted infectious and diseases, interracial genital anxiety. In the first place, the white physician is not accustomed to treating colored patients, and especially in cases of this kind where he must actually handle the privates of colored men in order to get results. The fact is that they do not do it, but leave it to the hospital attendants, and the men are consequently neglected. In many cases, men are discharged from the hospital before they are thoroughly well. If these men perchance be members of the labor battalion, it would be to their detriment to do laborious work. Therefore, I recommend colored physicians for colored troops. I consider this to be absolutely necessary for the good of the service. While it was perhaps indecorous for Loving to state in print, there was no greater symbol of the problem of Black futurity for white doctors and Black leaders during World War I than Black male genitalia. And here's where the story, as they say, gets interesting. Anxieties around race, sexuality, and genitalia produced two parallel and at times overlapping projects of Black masculine perfectibility and restraint within the US military at home and abroad. The presence of sexually infectious Black soldiers provided the rationale used by white Army doctors to enact novel and conventional modes of sexual control and their efforts to discipline the bodies and the desires of Black servicemen stationed overseas. While some of these physicians would go on to claim the experimental regulation of Black male sexuality as a technological success, African-American leaders touted the clean body of the African-American soldier, sanitized in the crucible of war, as a matter of masculine will rather than medicine. Since the stigma of sexual infections troubled the discourse of Negro futurity and imperiled the project of expanded citizenship rights, internal and external debates about the sexual health of Black soldiers gained a greater significance in the ongoing quest for national inclusion. By critiquing and contesting the discourse of the Black venereal body in professional journals, making direct outreach efforts to Black troops stateside and abroad, and deploying a discourse of racial hagiography in Black periodicals and memoir, leaders of the African-American professional class employed the trope of the sanitized Black soldier during and after the war, brandishing his sexual restraint and their broader claims for citizenship rights. In all, the ringing charge of venereal subversion transformed Black male bodies into sites of battle and medical experimentation by the end of World War I. Evaluating the health of African-American recruits was not Major Loving's primary reason for touring stateside camps, but he was confronted with overwhelming evidence of carelessness in their medical treatment and ignorance among the soldiers themselves. He had no problems admitting the truth of what War Department statistics had presented as a damning fact. The dramatic proportionate difference between rates of venereal disease among Black and white soldiers. In 1917, 63,586 servicemen were hospitalized for venereal disease. Over 59,000 were white and 4,000 were Black, creating a rate of 109.1 cases per 1,000 men for white troops, compared to 310.5 cases for Black soldiers. Far from viewing these statistics as a permanent indictment of Black manhood, however, Loving believed that proper education of soldiers and effective treatment by physicians would bring the Black venereal rate down to acceptable levels. In the vast number of camps he visited, however, these guidelines were imperfectly implemented, if at all. Army policy held that all suspected venereal subjects be quarantined until they were cured and ready to return to active service. Loving believed in the principle of quarantine and took efforts to explain its military rationale to the Black soldiers he met on his tour, who viewed it as an extension of the larger system of racist control they were experiencing. But in Loving's view, white officers were less interested in protecting Black soldiers from one another, making quarantine procedures null and void, and creating an undue stigma on Black soldiers as a whole. Eradicating this stigma became a point of activism for Black community leaders, who engaged modes of advocacy and outreach in their efforts to remove the venereal taint from Black soldiers during World War I. Writing in Black newspapers, professional journals, and in memoirs, these men and women expended considerable energy rebutting arguments made by white health practitioners that Black bodies were morally suspect and prone to disease, thus making African Americans unfit to serve in the war. A number of Black physicians partnered with the War Department during World War I and mounted a stateside campaign against VD in and around the camps where Black troops were stationed in significant numbers. These VD tours gave African American health practitioners occasion to spread the gospel of social hygiene through lectures, educational pamphlets, and slide projector presentations, especially prepared to meet the needs of all men, even those men who could not read. Doctors like Charles Roman gave lectures that couched Victorian codes of sexual morality into patriotic appeals, imploring soldiers in Illinois, Georgia, and Virginia to, quote, extend the influence of our flag and to widen the borders of freedom, end quote, while refraining from sexual activity. His bombastic appeals were reportedly heard by over 20,000 people alone. And after showing his audience slides that demonstrated what King Pox and Madam Clap had done for mankind, Roman concluded his talks with a progressive nod towards the technocratic success of prophylaxis. Quote, remember, those around the throne had on robes that were white, not because they had never been soiled, but because they had been washed. If you fall in the ditch, call for help. Apply for the prophylactic treatment, end quote. The prophylactic treatment promoted by Black social hygienists in their stateside roadshows was conceived and administrated by two white American doctors who left a lasting imprint on the regulation of Black male sexuality during the war. In 1917, Hugh Hampton Young and George Walker, professors of urology at the Johns Hopkins Medical School, had joined the ranks of civilian doctors who actively sought and received commissions to serve as medical officers in the AEF. Young and Walker had taught at Johns Hopkins since the turn of the century. Only a year apart in age, the late 40-something doctors were both well-respected in the practice and research of genitourinary surgery. Each went on to have celebrated careers after World War I, especially Hugh Hampton Young, who is regarded to this day as the father of modern American urology. As the first president of the American Association of Genitourinary Surgeons said of him, quote, the prostate makes most men old, but it made Hugh Hampton young. Up until World War I, the transmission of diseases such as syphilis and gonorrhea during military conflicts had become a readily accepted fact of modern warfare. However, General John Pershing, commander-in-chief of the AEF, believed that a fight against venereal diseases had to be waged in order for the United States to win the war. In order to make the U.S. military the cleanest army in the world, U.S. doctors adopted new and novel treatment regimens to safeguard American soldiers from VD. Young was not only an advocate of Pershing's quest to make the AEF the cleanest army in the world, he quickly became one of its primary architects. After reaching Europe, he was appointed director of the Division of Urology, which placed him in charge of all urological and venereal disease work in the AEF. The centerpiece of his treatment, which I should say was adopted from New Zealand doctors, was the use of chemical prophylaxis, an experimental method of curtailing venereal infection after possible exposure through the direct application of chemicals on the genitalia. At special prophylactic stations, silver compounds known to have antiseptic qualities were injected into the patient's penis through the urethra and held for 5 minutes. Afterwards, an ointment of calomel, otherwise known as mercury chloride, was rubbed over the external genitalia for 3 more minutes. Now, if this sounds gruesome, it was meant to be. Military urologists theorized that the administration of prophylaxis had not only therapeutic, but also behavioral effects upon the sexual conduct of soldiers. George Walker, who followed Young as urologist-in-chief of the AEF in 1919, wrote the definitive history of America's crusade against venereal disease in France, VD in the AEF force, in the American Expeditionary Forces. And he believed that, quote, much of the glamour and romance of illicit love will be lost if men can be impressed with the necessity of prophylactic measures after each exposure. As evidence of their technocratic victory over venereal disease during the war, Walker and Young cited the reduction of high rates of venereal disease among African-American stevedores stationed at Saint-Nazaire, France, and later in the port cities of Brest and Bordeaux through the use of chemical prophylaxis. Saint-Nazaire was the first seaport base expropriated for American use during the war, and its medical officers were aware as early as October 1917 that its men were contracting high rates of venereal disease. The logics of Jim Crow rule were part and parcel of the efforts used to reduce VD among African Americans working as stevedores on the docks of Saint-Nazaire, whose off-duty activities were believed to include sexual encounters or having sexual encounters with French civilians. In evaluating the racial and sexual logics at play in crafting this proposal, it should be noted that Young was unabashed in his opposition to sexual relations occurring between Black men and white women. In his autobiography, he recalled a visit to the 92nd, quote-unquote, or American Negro Division, headquarters in Bourbon-les-Bains, where he met with its medical officers to discuss the venereal problem. To his surprise, he discovered that all the doctors, lieutenants, and captains were Black, or were Black that day. Young used this opportunity to make his thoughts about interracial sexuality known. Quote, I talked very frankly about the insurmountable barrier between the two races, the necessity of leaving white women alone, and their duty as officers to impress these facts upon their men. I heard afterwards that my remarks did little good, and most of these Negro doctors became engaged to French girls, end quote. So upon learning that French women apparently, quote unquote, had no aversion to colored troops, Young recommended a number of measures implemented in December of that year, which specifically restricted the movement of African-American soldiers in the port city. He ordered a barbed wire stockade built around the stevedore camp, and guards were placed at the entrance. Whenever a soldier left the confines of his camp for any reason, he was required to take a prophylactic treatment upon his return. The effects of compulsory prophylaxis were magical, according to Walker, and gave results which were not dreamed possible. Young agreed, writing in his autobiography, that compulsory prophylaxis had an instantaneous effect on the venereal rate, rapidly reducing it until it was as good or better than that of the white troops. He then followed this statement with an anecdote that hinted at the side effects compulsory prophylaxis had upon the genitalia of African-American dock workers, implying that the material gains made by this process of control did not come without pain for those involved. The colonel commanding one of these camps was approached by his Negro orderly, a regular who had been with him for some years. The orderly calmly announced that he wanted a change of station, whereupon the colonel said, "Corporal, you've never had an easier job. I simply send you on errands, 10 or 15 within the camp, and perhaps 15 or 20 outside the camp every day. You certainly can't object to such an easy job as this." "No, Colonel, the work ain't hard, and I don't mind how often you send me on errands inside the camp. It's them errands outside, because every time I comes back, they takes me to the prophylactic station, and I'm getting awful sore." Young was known by his colleagues for his off-color humor. The joke he told within his memoirs, that the Negro orderly's penis was made sore from repeated injections of silver compounds into his urethra and the continuous application of mercury chloride upon his genitalia, made light of what was, in theory, a eugenicist mode of social control, and in practice, a systematized form of torture endured by Black soldiers in France. Using humor, Young reified a belief that Black men were immune from pain, intellectually inferior, and inured against instruction. As such, their regulation during the war required reiterative modes of punishment that sought to make their bodies remember what their minds could never be expected to comprehend. Young and Walker received considerable notoriety from their time spent overseas in the AEF. Inducted as majors, both men earned promotions to colonel by war's end. They both returned to Johns Hopkins as victors in the crusade against venereal disease. And Walker's book received a favorable review in the British Medical Journal, which asserted, "It is evident that much can be done both in the way of prevention and cure when men are under discipline and the medical officers capable and energetic." Not to be outdone, Hugh Hampton Young achieved a success that endures till today. One of Hopkins' most celebrated surgeons and researchers, he is commonly referred to as the father of American neurology due to the numerous innovations he made in the field, including research and surgery upon intersex people. This designation arguably puts him in league with 19th century surgeon J. Marion Sims, considered by some as the father of modern gynecology. But when we remember that Sims achieved fame and contemporary infamy for perfecting a treatment for vaginal fistulas through his experiments upon free and enslaved African-American women, we might give pause to consider the ways in which the experimental use of Black male soldiers in World War I merged modes of military and medical knowledge production in a successive modernity that also found the sexual bodies of Black people dependable objects of analysis. And yet a question remains: how effective was chemical prophylaxis? As a senior consultant in urology for the AEF, Walker conducted a study that compared two groups of venereal contacts. The first group had contracted syphilis, gonorrhea, or chancroid after using prophylaxis, and the second group had contracted one of these ailments without taking prophylaxis at all. Comparing the two groups, Walker found that the rates of acquisition of the three diseases were nearly the same. In addition to the insignificant differences between the two sets of data, it should be noted that using chemical prophylaxis possibly increased the chances of contracting chancroid by 6%. Walker and the subsequent AEF historians who would cite his study would arrive at a different conclusion, however, arguing that prophylaxis, as used by us in the American Expeditionary Forces, and I'm quoting here, was equally effective against the three diseases. So while my study does not necessarily dispute claims made by American doctors that chemical prophylaxis was effective in treating sexual infections, I do think it might compel us to consider additional reasons for the magical and brilliant successes of reduced rates among African-American soldiers in France. What seems most apparent to me is that the intense restriction of movement placed upon Black soldiers in port cities, complete with a punitive mode of sexual control, limited the access those soldiers had to the sexual commerce the war engendered, in which venereal disease operated as one powerful sign or receipt of exchange. Historian Adrienne Lynn Smith cites evidence of this restricted movement in an unpublished letter to The Crisis, written by a sympathetic white captain in Bordeaux, who was astounded to learn his company of Black stevedores had received only 2 days off and 6 weeks of dock work, with those on the night shift working up to 14 hours without food. Arthur Barbeau and Florette Henry also point to the fact that when military officials placed French brothels off limits to all American soldiers, the rates of VD quickly fell for both Black and white troops. Once the restrictions were lifted, the white rate began to climb again. However, because of the compulsory prophylaxis of Black soldiers, which again entailed not only mandatory treatment, but also a restriction of movement, the Black rate continued to drop until it hit a low incident rate of 30 exposures per 1,000 men. White Army doctors who treated African Americans during the Great War were instrumental in institutionalizing the idea of the Negro venereal within medical and military discourse. They authorized their experiences and opinions in medical journals and at professional conferences once the war had officially ended and they returned to their civilian lives. George Day, a physician who treated patients at Camp Pike in Arkansas and Camp Alexander in Virginia, said at the 71st meeting of the American Medical Association in 1920, quote, "It is my belief practically all Negroes are venereals. Why this is true is quite easily understood. Furthermore, it is my belief that comparatively few are ever cured of their venereal disease. When an occasional one is cured, he betakes himself to his usual haunts to become quickly reinfected. I am convinced that the majority of Negroes do not respect the moral code or honor the sanctity of wedlock. So the endless chain of infection and reinfection goes merrily on," end quote. But now, a century removed from these statistics themselves, I think that we might consider these venereal disease reports in a slightly different way. Draconian measures had been taken to discipline the bodies and the desires of African-American soldiers, making the medical apparatus of the U.S. military a vital mediator of the overlapping taxonomies of race, class, gender, and citizenship in the Army. While the intersecting stigmas of race and sexuality gave credence to the belief in the Black venereal body, we might also view increased venereal rates among Black troops as acts of marinage, small escapes made against the ruling military orthodoxy, as well as the politics of respectability espoused by African-American leaders on the home front, who utilized the figure of the clean Black soldier in order to secure citizenship rights for the larger Black community in the United States. In 1898, myths of immunity secured the overseas employment of African-American military workers. By 1917, military medical discourse viewed Black men serving in the European theater as flagrantly venereal. Punitive attempts by U.S. military officials to discipline the bodies and the desires of African-American soldiers indicate that the idea of the Negro venereal had consolidated within the civil military discourse with all the coherence of a species. This stigma merged two contradictory ideas, immunity and contagion, into the figure of the African-American military worker and played a central role and the technical, biological, and political regulation and containment of Black soldiers abroad. And yet importantly, the racist management of African American soldiers in France was far from a totalizing project. Black soldiers' own practices of marinage signified upon the trope of venereal subversion by appropriating the discourse of contagion that rationalized their regulation and control. Though viewed as subaltern actors in the European theater of operations, thousands of Black men made their own temporary escapes from white supremacist surveillance, as well as the politics of respectability in their travels across France, asserting their racial difference and whetting their sexual curiosity in the contact zones produced by global conflict. Thank you very much.
Dr. Khary Oronde Polk, thank you so very much. We really appreciate your study and your contribution to our conversations on not only World War I, but also our understandings of modern American medicine, whether or not it is Henrietta Lack or this Tuskegee study. There is much that we can learn from our modern American medicine that was taken from Black history. And we really appreciate how you are delving into that in your book, Contagions of Empire. We've got a couple of questions that I want to go ahead and connect with. I do want to encourage you, if you're joining us via Zoom, it is in that Q&A section. And if you're joining us on Facebook Live, we would love for you to ask your questions in the comment lineup. Some of our museum staff will be sure to share that information with me. But this question comes from Mary Frances. Dr. Polk, thank you for your work and for sharing it with us tonight. A couple of questions for you. When did medical narratives surrounding Black men begin to change in the scientific community, or pseudoscientific, as it might be? And as a follow-up, when and why did those presumptions begin to break down in mainstream circles like academia? It's a lot for you to unpack in just a matter of minutes.
Right, no, but it's a fantastic question. I mean, I can say how the narrative around prophylaxis continued after World War I. And World War II, it created a new medical intervention. And so instead of using chemical prophylaxis, there was the invention of sulfa drugs. And so sulfa drugs began to be used. And in fact, used in the same way in which chemical prophylaxis had been used in World War I. And there were other medical doctors that studied Black men in the same way and would give Black men sulfa drugs before they went out on pass. And then again, when they came back. And so we begin to, that is something that continued to happen. So in many ways, nothing changed, arguably, at least in terms of the military use of Black men in their experiments around BD between World Wars I and II for the actual medicine being used. But I would say that within that period, I believe that the Tuskegee syphilis experiment began around 1932, 1933. And that's an important moment because I believe it lasted for about 30 years. It lasted until 1972, so my math, maybe it's 40 years. And I would say that the fact that there were African Americans who were drafted during World War II who were part of the study, that was an interesting moment because those men received deferments because they were seen as more valuable as research studies, as research subjects than they would have been as soldiers who fought in World War II. And so we might say that there was an eye-opening moment when the the Tuskegee study became public. And that is in the early 1970s. And I think that changed a lot in terms of how scientists and researchers began to think differently about Black men, Black women, Black people. But one might argue that some of these ideas are still with us today in terms of how African Americans are viewed by the medical field and researchers overall.
Well, and that is actually going to take us to our next question, which comes from Jay Kidd. Given the separate rates of infection and treatment for COVID-19 for Black Americans, what steps can we take today to begin to thwart the pernicious legacy of eugenics in medicine? Again, there will be no easy questions for you this evening, Dr.
No. I think that the first step in, let's say, extinguishing a legacy is probably acknowledging it. Mm-hmm. So I think that thinking the long arc of whether it's medical innovation is something I think that we should hold on to. I'm not in favor of pretending that that these histories of exploitation occurred. And I think that if we think about that, we then can begin to come up with new solutions and new ways of discussing COVID-19 for all marginalized populations, particularly populations who we know are more susceptible, not because of biological difference, but often because of social and economic circumstance. Thinking about one of the parallels, I would say that though I don't spend so much time in this chapter in the book, but also what I spoke about today, is thinking about the role of African American women as fever nurses during the Spanish American War, and that the idea of thinking about their work and the belief that they were immune to yellow fever was itself that was a helpful myth for American military officials to tell themselves. And thinking about that in relationship to essential workers today, and thinking about the disproportionate role of people of color in those roles, we might also think about, what myths are we telling ourselves to make us feel better about this disproportionate sacrifice of people. In order to make America go better. I won't say great.
I know it is, there are a tremendous number of great things, and great things always come at a cost. That is a lecture on economics that you can also find on our YouTube channel and understand all the things about opportunity cost, which is also integrated into history. There are two more questions. So there's actually more than two, but I think we will try to fit the last two in.
I spoke so long, it's like, I guess maybe it is what it is, but
No, it's spectacular. The first is gonna be from Matt Barrett, who is joining us from Facebook Live, who said, were French officials also part of the investigation? Why was their obsession concerning Black genitalia and miscegenation of French women? My understanding was that the French were more receptive to Black Americans opposed to their military counterparts.
Right, I think that, so American officials, American military officials attempted to conscript French officials into their own Jim Crow logics. And this became a site of tension between American military officials and French officials, because this wasn't something that meant a lot to them in terms of the literature that I've read. And so there are certain letters that in fact W.E.B. Du Bois published in The Crisis that sort of talked about the letters that that French officials received that tried to say that, okay, we have to learn Jim Crow, and these are the new rules that we're going to play by. But apparently, like, those rules themselves were never put in action. And so this is a moment where I think, thinking globally, as I think the work that the National World War One Museum does, is really helpful. Because, I mean, something that seems either very niche, such as either protocols around prostitution or, sexually transmitted infections, they have such ramifications when understood globally, and especially during times of war. And so I think that this is one of the moments in where we have to begin to think about those differences having global impacts and creating global frictions among allies.
And the last question is going to be from Sharika Crawford, who asks a question that we think about at the National World War I Museum and Memorial, and we are really looking forward to your answer to it. She starts off with, "Thank you for your talk, Dr. Polk. Much of our understanding of Black American soldiers in World War I is viewed through the lens of Black labor rather than combat, notable exception, Harlem Hellfighters. How might we reconceptualize Black American military contribution as essential laborers rather than just combatants?"
Thank you. I think it's a great question, and I sometimes wonder how other military historians will think of this work, because I myself am less invested in combat, and I am interested in all, I would say, the texture of life in the military that is not as invested and who wins and who loses on the battlefield. And I think I remember seeing a couple months ago a quote on Twitter, someone wrote, I think it was, it may have been a graduate student, very frustrated, who did military history, and that the idea of gender history wasn't seen as military history. So it was, when you can kind of clap things out online. And so the quote was gender history is military history. And I loved it. And in many ways, it's like, I wanted to sort of, and it's not just gender, right, as one of the optics that we think about. So I think that it's important for us to talk about the labor of African-American soldiers, specifically because, and this is something, there's tension here that, and I understand both sides. There has been a understandable need for people to recover the bravery and the courage of African-American soldiers in combat. And that says everything about the role of Black soldiers in American history. And why African-American soldiers, will fight for a country that doesn't always, respect them, respect their own intrinsic rights. But I think that in doing so, we can become captivated by certain narratives that move towards a hagiographic, right? And so we need to find a truer history of the Tuskegee Airmen, or the 92nd Division. And I'm actually interested in the narratives of people that are either, the common folk or folks whose stories just haven't been told. So thinking about narratives of military wives. In fact, one of, if you can call it a subject or subjects, I spend my first chapter writing about soldiers who died from yellow fever and thinking about the idea of what does it mean, the difference between dying in battle and dying from a disease, and a discourse of American military honor. And I want to hold on to the idea of thinking about these dead bodies as actually having their own stories and telling us a lot about what it means for us to honor folks using these metrics. So I would say that it is important for us to think both about combat, but also just quotidian life in the military for all Americans and for all soldiers, and to think deeply about how including those narratives and what we already have, just gives us a better perspective on the wars that we study.
Thank you so very much. And we want to echo that and hope that some of the resources that you might be able to find on theworldwar.org do support the exploration of more stories that were affected by the war. And it is not just those who are actively involved in combat. It takes so much more than those who are on the front line in any war, and very much so within World War I. We have a spectacular online exhibition called Make Way for Democracy that has been there since, I believe, 2016. And one of the things that we have embedded into that is actually images of Black men and women who served, who were part of this effort, whose names we don't know, so because they weren't included. So when you talk about the everyday American, we are on the hunt in part for some of those stories. So if you are watching this right now on Facebook Live, on Zoom, or if you're watching this on YouTube later on, we would really invite you to go to our website, take a look at the exhibition section, and take a look at those images. We are hopeful that in crowdsourcing, we might gather more of that, because that is an essential part of the narrative that is just not always included. And it tells the more complex portion of history. And that is part of what makes history so important to the present. Present life is never easy, and history is incredibly complex. When you get a chance to really take a look at it, it can be so informative for our present and for our understanding of who we have been and who we are today. Also, if you are looking for some more information about reconceptualizing Black American military contribution in World War I, we would always suggest you take a look at some of our author friends and advisors. Chad Williams has written extensively and has a new book coming out on W.E.B. Du Bois. Also, someone you mentioned earlier, Adrienne Lynn Smith. Her book is called Freedom Struggles, African Americans in World War I. You can find both of them as part of our program offerings and lectures on our YouTube channel. Easy enough to find those if you go to the upper right-hand corner on the website, theworldwar.org. That's where you will find this lecture later on. And if you enjoyed it, be sure to share that with those in your networks, because we really know that this history is so foundational to the 20th and the 21st centuries. Dr. Khary Oronde Polk, thank you so much for joining us. Thank you for using one of our artifacts as the cover of your book. We love to help provide some of that primary source and some of that opportunities for research. And as we may be getting more questions, we will certainly forward those on to you if you are open to it.
Completely. Thank you so much. It's been a wonderful opportunity. And please, please visit the museum virtually and in person.
And take a look at your independent bookstores.
Yes, indeed.